How's your week been? Are you ready to start a new week? Was it busy? Did you feel frantic? Did news coming out from whether it's Governor DeWine or wherever you live have you sort of frazzled? Guess what? Worship is the moment you hit the pause button and get to reset your heart, your mind, and your soul to remember that God is your creator and He made you for a purpose. That God is good and deserves your glory and your honor, and that ultimately He is on His throne, and regardless of what's going on in the world or even in your life, that if you walk with Him by faith, that things will work out the way that they're supposed to for your ultimate good and His ultimate glory. You see, worship is the place where you and I get motivation to commit to things that matter most in life. Worship is the place where we get stability to calm us when we suffer and face difficulties. And worship is the place where you're reminded of what ultimately matters out of all the things happening in your life. So let me encourage you now to not jump in and out of this video if you're on a social media site, to not be distracted by all the things that are around you. Take a minute, press pause on the video, get all your things ready, and enter into a season, a moment, some time to dedicate yourself to worship. Don't answer the texts. Don't answer the phone calls. Don't check your email. Just worship God.
Comfort. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Many times I have looked at communion as a special event, not to discredit any other acts of worship, which are singing, praying, preaching, and giving. It's just that communion is an opportunity for us to clear our minds and think about the sacrifice that Jesus Christ has made for each and every one of us. We are blessed people. But in 1 Corinthians 11, chapter verse 21 and 22, Paul is found rebuking the church of Corinth because they are conducting a Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. They have begun to bring their own food. They have begun to turn the Lord's Supper into a physical dinner instead of a spiritual supper in respect to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So in the 23rd verse through the 26th verse, Paul begins to correct them and identify to them how they should conduct the service. And it reads, starting at verse 23, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he comes." Dropping down to the 28th verse, Paul tells them to self-examine themselves before they partake of the Lord's Supper. I found this very interesting because on the very night that Jesus Christ was betrayed, the disciples had to examine themselves after Christ had told them that someone at the table was going to betray him. If at that point they began to say, "Is it I?" We today make this same self-examination of ourselves before we go to the Lord with the supper. We have to look inside ourselves to see if we are working worthily, if we are showing love one toward another. And in 2 Corinthians 13, chapter verse 5 tells us to examine ourselves to see if we are in the faith. We truly are a blessed people to have Jesus Christ as our Savior and our Redeemer. And with those thoughts, let us go to the Father with the bread. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Father God, we approach your throne of mercy, thanking you for your love, patience, and grace. We thank you for forgiving us of our sins, which were many. Father, we come before you asking your blessing on the bread, which is a representation of your Son's body, which was crucified on Calvary's hill. I pray that you will bless it and a partaker of it. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Let's go to the Father with the cup. Our Father God in heaven, we come before you thanking you for allowing your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to give his life for us, that we may have a chance for eternal life. He too loved us so much that he gave his body in obedience to you and a sacrifice for us. It is the shedding of his blood which is able to wash away sins, and we are forever grateful. We pray that you will bless this cup, which is a representation of Christ's shed blood. And it's in Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Jesus.
Prayer, more than heaven or hell, Jesus in his earthly ministry spoke about money. He was concerned about greed because greed is so dangerous and it's very difficult for us to see. Becoming generous is quite a difficult thing to do. So how do we become a good giver? There are a few options. First, I could tell you that you must give or God will get you. By doing so, I'd be working on your will. Another thing I could do is tell you, look at all these hurting and lost people. You must give to them. That would be working on your emotions. I could also tell you, giving to this cause is the most efficient way to save souls. Our dollar per soul cost is excellent. That would be working on your mind. And all of these actually fall short to changing our heart. In Acts chapter 20, in verse 32, Paul said to the Ephesian elders, "And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among the saints." Grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. Paul says that the beautiful word of grace builds us up and makes us strong and informs us of how rich we are eternally. And when we understand how gracious God has been to us, it changes not our will, not our emotions, not just our mind, but it gets all the way down to changing our hearts and converts us to becoming generous like God. Let's give thanks to God now for his abundant grace as we consider the kind of givers he has called us to be. Father God in heaven, you are the ultimate giver, and you have shown us exactly what it means to sacrifice for the good of others. And you have taught us that that is what brings about the greatest amount of joy when we learn to lay down our lives and to give. Father, would you help us to give even in times of fear and uncertainty so that we can build people up and bring them to you. And Father, would you help us to be recipients of those who want to give to us. Help us to be those who can receive not only gifts when we need them, but also relationships and connection and support and encouragement so that we could become the kind of family that you have designed us to be. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Our scripture reading is Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we are in, how Jerusalem lies in ruins with its gates burned. Come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer suffer derision." And I told them of the hand of my God that had been upon me for good, and also of the words that the king had spoken to me. And they said, "Let us rise up and build." So they strengthened their hands for the good work. When a person becomes a Christian, there are two sentences that they should never say. The first one is, "You don't need me." And the second one is, "I don't need you." You see, woven into the fabric of becoming a Christian is the very idea that we are a community that collaborates together as we work together in the kingdom of God. The work that God has given us to do is bigger than anything that one person can do alone. God has called us to do big things in His name. Things like revival of a nation or a state or a city, the revival or rejuvenation of a church, the reconciliation of relationships, and even just the transformation of my own life. All of these things are bigger than just what one person can do on their own. And so God has called us to learn what it means to collaborate and work together as the body of His people. We've come to this part of the story of Nehemiah where they are ready to begin building the wall that God has called Nehemiah to raise them up to do. We met Nehemiah in chapter 1 where we found him with a great burden on his heart that he wanted the people of God and the city of God to be rebuilt so that the shame that they were experiencing would be no more. And he spent 4 months fasting and weeping and praying for the opportunity to see this happen. And because of the situation that God put him in, he had access to King Artaxerxes of the Persian Empire who he could ask permission to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild. Well, 4 months after hearing the news, he was standing before the king and the door was open for him to take that step and ask the king for permission. The hand of God was on him and the king allowed him to go back to Jerusalem, even providing authority and provisions for the walls to be rebuilt. And here in this part of the story, we see Nehemiah show up, and it's time to call the people of God together to get them to collaborate and build this wall. You see, Nehemiah knew he himself alone could not physically build this wall. He needed everyone to be involved. You see, church, right now, more than ever, We, as the body of Christ, God's people, have a work, have a job to do that is going to require collaboration. As we look around and consider what it means to be the church and how we serve each other, how we edify each other, how we keep each other walking hand in hand with Christ, how we encourage to strengthen each other's faith and keep hope alive. As we consider how we do this together to show love to each other and be a light to the world, a city on a hill, and we look around and realize that all the things that we have had prior to this moment that have allowed us to do those things, to minister to each other, to care for each other, and to demonstrate to the world what the gospel is, all of those ways that we have had to do that before seem like they're just dismantled. And so now, more than ever, as the church, we have to collaborate together to do this wonderful work that God has given to us. So I want to get into Nehemiah, the end of chapter 2 and all of chapter 3, to learn from Nehemiah the principles of collaboration, the power of collaboration, and ultimately the person who drives us to be willing to collaborate together. But let's start first with the principles. You see, in chapter 3, we've come to this chapter that's kind of similar to other chapters in the Bible where there's just a long list of names that are hard to pronounce. And as you read through it, you might be tempted to skip over it. We're not going to read through all the verses right now together, but I would encourage you to do that. And as you read through that chapter, you'll see some principles emerge about how they learned to collaborate. And the first principle is this, that true collaboration means that everyone must be involved. Everyone. The whole congregation of God's people there in Jerusalem had to participate for this wall to be built. There were men and there were women. There were priests and Levites. There were rulers of the city, gatekeepers and farmers, perfume makers and jewelers, pharmacists. There were all these different people who were not wall builders by trade, but made a commitment to collaborate together to build this wall. You see, the same is true for the church. Paul gives us this image in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 that the church is like a body, that every member of the body is a different part, and all of those parts have to work together for the body to be able to function the way that it was supposed to function. Every single member of the body of Christ is essential for that body to work properly. If you're missing just one member of that body, it may still be able to limp along and do some things, but it will not work as effective as it could without everybody participating. So principle number one is that everyone must be involved. And principle number two is that everyone must work together. In chapter 3, there's two phrases that pop up on a regular basis. As you read the name of the person or the family that's working, every once in a while you'll see it says after him or next to him as they move to the next person or the next family that's working. And what it's saying is that all of these people are working together to build the wall. You see, the way a wall is built is not just in sections where they go vertically in one little part, but a wall is built not vertically, but horizontally. Row number one has to be built, and then row number two, and these stones have to be woven together as they work their way up from the bottom to the top. So if I'm working side by side with another family or another person, as I get to finishing row number four and I come to the end, I'm going to need that person to pick up where I stop and build their part of the wall. And then they'll come back to row five and then row six, and we work together for this to happen. You see, when we view our work together as the body of Christ, doing the will of God in this world, we can't just view ourselves as individual silos, disconnected from other people, just doing our job. What's beautiful about this is actually we get to see ourselves working together. So as I minister to somebody else, as I care for somebody else, as I make a phone call or send a text or write a card or I take some food or I care for somebody in that way, there's opportunities for others to be caring for maybe that person or me in the very same moment. The work that God has given us to do allows us to work not just on something important, but to work together in ministry. So principle number one is that everyone must be involved. Principle number two is that everyone must work together. Now, principle number three is that everyone must work where they are. You'll notice in verse 10 of chapter 3, it says that they were working opposite of their house. In verse 23, it says they were working next to their front door. And the idea is this, that where they lived, where they dwelt, the place where they were is the place where God called them to work. You see, these people were not called to work in other places or to do somebody else's job. They weren't called to go 2 miles away or 6 miles away. They were called to work right where God put them. And this principle shows up over and over in the Bible. Jesus, in his ministry, when he would heal somebody, they would often ask him, hey, can we, you know, leave everything and join you and walk with you? And he would say, no, I want you to go back home to the place where you're from and tell them what the Lord has done for you. We see this show up where in places in the New Testament where we're told that God has appointed the times and places for us to be because he's called us to work in the places that we are. God puts you in the place you are with the people that you're around to provide ministry to them. So your neighbors, your coworkers, your family members, you were given to those particular people to minister to them. So as we consider how we minister to each other in the church, how we bear each other's burdens right now, how we share love for each other, how we edify and encourage each other in the faith right now, you have been given a particular set of people that you are close to, that you're near to, that you know, that God has called you to care for. So I want to encourage you as you consider maybe the church that you're a part of, if you're a member of our congregation here locally, large enough that you personally can't phone every single person on the directory or text every single person every day, to think about the people that are in your life that you can influence. If you're not a member of our congregation locally, but wherever you come from, I want to encourage you to consider the people in your life that you can build up, that you can encourage, that you can strengthen, so that you can work where you are. So everyone, number one, has to be involved. Everyone must work together, number two. And number three, everyone must work where they are. And finally, principle number four is this. Everyone must complete their work. You see, it was so important for them when they were building this wall that everybody finished the work that was in front of them. This wall did not come to completion if somebody finished their job, but another person didn't finish their job. What was important is that they all brought this work to completion. What we'll learn about next week is that they actually faced a lot of difficulty, a lot of challenges when it came to doing the work that they were called to do. They had enemies and they had circumstances that made it really challenging to do their work, but they found the strength and had the endurance to do this work because they felt a burden and a responsibility to each other, to Nehemiah, and to God himself to do the work that they were called to do. You see, responsibility is the mark of spiritual maturity. When we start to bear a burden on our hearts, a burden of responsibility to do the work that is in front of us to do, that is when we begin to mature in the work that God has given us to do. So these individuals and us hopefully will learn these principles of what it means to collaborate together to do the work of God. But we're still going to need some momentum, some force to drive us to be willing to collaborate. And that brings us to point number two, that there is a power of collaboration. You see, collaboration is not our natural instinct in our flesh. Under the bondage of sin, Satan has lied to us and convinced us that separating and dividing is the most effective thing to do, that it's safer, that it's the right way to live our lives, and it's just not true. We have this predisposition, this bend towards pulling away from people, to grab the reins and say, let me just do this all by myself, and all these other people don't know what they're doing. Satan has convinced us that we can do so much better than anybody else, and if we can just do it by ourselves, it'll be done better. That's simply not true. We're going to need a power that moves us, that forces us, a momentum that drives us to want to collaborate, because we in our own selves, lost in sin, will not be willing to do this. And if you look back in our reading in chapter 2, starting in verse 17, Nehemiah shows us where we get the power to want to collaborate. So the power of collaboration comes first from seeing the destruction, noticing how big the problem is. Look around there. Nehemiah says in verse 17, I want you to see the destruction of the city. Now, what's interesting about this is that they have lived there for years, actually. They knew it. They were watching it. They had seen it all around them. But for some reason, they had grown dull to caring. They had grown dull to this really bothering them. And so when Nehemiah says, I want you to see the destruction, he's not just saying, I want your eyes to be able to capture that the walls are broken down. He's saying, I want you to be aware of this problem. And I want it to bother you. I want you to care. You see, we won't really begin to collaborate together. We won't have the force or the momentum to get ourselves together and fight for and work for something bigger than ourselves together until we see that there's a problem that we're facing. Loving and caring and serving for the body of Christ, the people of God, protecting his people and building them up, sharing the gospel to those outside of us as a city on a hill and a light in the world is such a big responsibility and a job that we must do that we are forced to realize we must collaborate if we're going to do it well. So Nehemiah wants them to see the destruction, but he also wants them to see their place in the purpose. You notice at the end of verse 17, he says, look around, see the destruction. But I want you and me, us, to rise up and build the walls to remove the reproach. Notice, first of all, he uses the word us. Nehemiah doesn't say, I want you to help me rebuild the wall. Nehemiah is not saying, it's me that's going to rebuild it, and will you help me do it? Nehemiah absolutely sees himself as part of this group of people, and he says, I want us to do this. We are going to do this together. And when we do this, this is your place in it, but when we do this, we're going to remove the reproach from us. You see the purpose there? He's saying, I want us to build the wall, not just because I feel like having a wall or I want us to make something beautiful for our city. He's saying there's a greater purpose than just what I want us to do or what I think we should do, but us together are going to build this wall to remove the reproach from God's people. You see, they knew this, that all the places around them, the cities, the nations that were surrounding them were mocking them. They were in shame and they were in danger. And Nehemiah is calling them to see their place in the purpose of building this wall. You and I have a place personally in the purpose of the work of the church today. Caring for each other, ministering to each other, checking on each other, loving each other right now, more than ever, is so important. And you and I together have to build this, have to work together. We have a place in this purpose of building up each other's faith so that we can reach heaven together and share the gospel with those who are outside. So Nehemiah, driving this force of collaboration, wants them to see the destruction and also see their place in the purpose. But ultimately, he wants them to see the hand of God in what they're doing. Again, this is not just Nehemiah's dream and his hope for the city. This isn't just his vision of what he would like to see done. He shares with them in verse 18 that the hand of God is moving this. That this is from God, that it's not Nehemiah saying we just need a wall so that we can be a powerful city again, nor is it just King Artaxerxes saying, hey, I want Jerusalem as a better city for my kingdom, so build a wall for me. Nehemiah shares with them the story about how God has been with him way back when he was in Susa at the citadel, how God showed up and shared with him the burden, how God opened the door with the king, and how God made provision. He's over and over showing them that it's the hand of God that wants this wall to be built. Well, good news for us, church. The hand of God has revealed to us the work that we have been called to do to be the church today. This isn't just some dream of your elders or your evangelists who are saying, hey, we need to minister to each other and care for each other and check on each other. We need to be building the city of God, the people of God, the church. This is not just our dream or our idea. This is the hand of God that's calling us to do it. And he's calling you and I personally to be involved in this purpose. and to see what will happen if we don't, so that we will be motivated to collaborate together. You know, these people that were surrounding Nehemiah agreed to collaborate together. They agreed to do this work because they had the principles of collaboration. Yes, they bought into those principles and it helped them do this work. They had the power of collaboration. They had the momentum and force because Nehemiah led them to see how important this was. But at the end of the day, they had a person behind their collaboration. Nehemiah called them together. His presence brought them, a people who had been together for many years living in that city, but never collaborated together, never brought together to do this work. Nehemiah himself as a person shows up and in his presence calls them and draws them and unifies them together. You see, you learn a few things about Nehemiah. Special guy. He has a burden, a God-sized burden on his heart to love the city of God, to see it built, and to love the people of God, to see them protected. And when he shows up in Jerusalem, he's there all by himself and people don't know what he's doing. He spends 3 days out there inspecting and looking at all the damage and the ruin. And there he is. He returns after those 3 days to find the people ready for revival. And he inspires them to work. And they say, come, let us rise up and build. Let us rest and set our hands to this work to get this work done. And you and I have someone just like Nehemiah, but greater than Nehemiah, in the man Jesus Christ. The Son of God shows up. And when he shows up, people don't know that he's here and they don't know why he's here. But unlike Nehemiah, he doesn't just inspect our destruction. He experiences our destruction. He doesn't just look at the broken down walls. He absorbs the wrath of God for what we have broken down with our sin. And like Nehemiah, he's all alone in the darkness, in the night for 3 days. And after those 3 days, Jesus, after hanging on the cross, going into the tomb, and 3 days later, coming back to a people, doesn't just call us to revival. He himself draws us up into revival because of what he has done for us. You see, when Jesus walked out of the tomb, he left in that tomb our guilt for what we've done wrong, our shame and embarrassment for all the ways that we've believed about ourselves with sin, and he brought to us the defeat of our enemy death and the defeat of our destruction in sin. And he brought to us the gift of new life in him and new purpose in his kingdom. You want to find a purpose to give your life to? You want to find a purpose to fight for, something that is worth every ounce of your being? Look to the person of Jesus Christ, who gave himself completely for you to free you from the bondage of sin, to set you free for a purpose to give your entire life to the love and service and care of those who are around you, so that you can minister to those that you share with in the body of Christ, so that you can love and serve and build each other up, and so that we as the city of God being built in collaboration following Jesus Christ demonstrate to a watching world that there's something unique about those people. That regardless of race or class, regardless of education or experience, regardless of any differences, when they see us, the city of God, they see a people who collaborate because of Jesus Christ. And in doing so, declare to the world that you have been loved, you have been forgiven, and this is where you belong. If you have not yet become a member, a part of the body of Jesus Christ, if you have not yet really understood who he is and what he has done for you, the offer continually stands for you to call us, to text us, to email us. We want to help you know who Jesus is so that you can discover where you find forgiveness. You can discover where you find who you really are, your true identity, and where you can discover your ultimate true purpose for what you were called to give your entire life to. All you got to do is call or text the number on the screen to get a hold of us. We're here to help you become a Christian and follow Jesus the rest of your life.
You were the Word at the beginning. Videotaped church services. Can't wait till we can all be together again. If you have any needs, please feel free to contact us with the information provided at the end. For right now, let's just close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this day that you provided for us. We're thankful for the technology that allows us to have these times together. Father, we pray for those that are suffering through the illness of this virus and those suffering for other reasons also, Father. Father, we just ask you to be with us and keep us safe until we can meet again. For this, our prayer through your Son, Jesus' name, amen.